Okay, so now let's turn our attention to non-conservative forces again. So non-conservative forces, they have the property that the work done is path dependent. Okay, and work done in a round trip is non-zero. Okay, so the physical example of this is kinetic friction. Okay, and we will see several examples of this. Okay, now imagine this situation. This is a two-dimensional plane, like a tabletop or something, which is rough. And now on this, what we have is a block like this of mass m, which is at initial position A. Now, in one case, we are taking it from the initial position by a path like this. Okay. This is path one. So this is a rough horizontal surface. Okay. So this perpendicular axis is your vertical. So gravity is acting like this. Okay. So you're taking it from this position A to this position B. That is your path one. Whereas in the second case, your path is this one. You're taking it directly. So when I see the top view, it's like this. This is the position A of the block, and this is the final position B that we are moving it to. So in the second path, you are taking it directly like this. Whereas in the first path, we were taking it like this, let's say. With this angle is 90 degrees. So let's also say this distance here is A and this distance is B. So we can easily see here that as far as the work done by friction is concerned, how much is it in path one? From A to B. So a block of mass M is pushed from the position A to B by external agent on a horizontal surface which is of coefficient of friction mu, okay, as shown. Okay. Assume the external agent only pushes horizontally. That is no vertical force. Applied. Okay. So this is a very critical statement here, that if there's no vertical force applied, it means that the normal reaction will be equal to mg. So the kinetic friction acting on it will be equal to mu mg. So whether the block is moving in this path or this path, whatever, the kinetic friction acting will have a magnitude of mu mg. Now use this fact over here to work out how much is the work done in path A and how much is the work done in path B. And you'll immediately see that again, it is a path dependent quantity. It's not going to be the same in the two cases. So that demonstrates how kinetic friction is a non-conservative force. So just work this out. Yeah, you have to calculate and tell me, Prince, how much is the work done by friction in part A and part B? It's all for the same situation which I've shown you. Yeah, so how much is the work done in part A? Yes, it is correct. Nee, that is not the total work done. I'm just asking the work done by friction. No? So it's correct, the answer that you've given. Okay. So just want the work done by friction. So that will be how much in the first part. You should be getting the work done by friction as minus mu mg into A plus B. Whereas in the second part, you should be getting the work done by friction as minus mu mg into square root of a square plus b square. That is the hypotenuse itself. Yes, so Anmol, what you have given is the total work done. That's correct. The net work done is fine. It will be that like that only. But the work done by friction is what we are focusing on. And that will be this much only over here. Okay, because about the external force, we don't have any information whether it is uniform, non-uniform. No. So can't say. But about friction, we can give this information. Right, so hope everyone else has also understood. So what's happening, let's investigate this in more detail. So in the first path, as your body is moving from here to here, but during this part of the displacement from this position to this position, or rather this part of the motion, let's say if at some in-between time the body is here. Okay. So its differential displacement is in this direction and the kinetic friction acting on it will be in this direction and that will be equal to mu mg. Okay. So say this in-between point is C. So work done by friction from A to C plus C to B. Now when you are going in this direction, again displacement and kinetic friction, they are acting in opposite directions. So you can see that here also, it is going to be minus of kinetic friction into the distance. And here also it is going to be minus of kinetic friction into the distance. And kinetic friction is mu n, that is mu mg. Okay. That is how it is becoming minus of mu mg into a plus b for the first path. Now likewise, when you look at the second path, see, you know, because this angle is 90, here the distance is root of a square plus b square. But while moving along this path, again, displacement and kinetic friction are opposite. So in path 2, but more importantly, then you can see that the work done in path 1 is not equal to the work done by path 2. So which clearly indicates that kinetic friction is a non-conservative force. Yeah, Arvinda, then answer is negative because see, the direction of friction is opposite to the direction of displacement, no? So in the dot product, there will be cos 180, no? Okay, so hope this example is clear to everyone. Now we come to something very important next. Through this concept of conservative and non-conservative forces, we will express another definition for a system, and that is the definition of potential energy, okay, and its relationship with conservative force. Generally denoted with the symbol U. So we define potential energy like this, that if a system has, or you know, we can say like this, wait, we will just call potential energy, it is the energy of a system associated with its state. Just like kinetic energy is the energy of the system associated with its motion. Okay. So basically, if a system has some internal, and these have to be conservative, we will discuss why later. If it has some internal conservative forces such that to change its state, we can call it state or configuration. Work has to be done, okay, against the internal conservative force. Then the system possesses a type of mechanical energy called potential energy. Okay, so it possesses a type of mechanical energy called potential energy, such that delta U, that is the change in the potential energy, equals to the work done against its internal conservative force. To change the state of the system. Okay, so I'll explain in more detail with examples. Just note down this definition first, that if a system has this property that it has some energy associated with its state, and therefore to change the state or the configuration of the system, external agent needs to do work against its internal force. Then we say that the system has potential energy, and the change in potential energy equals to the work which you have to do against the internal conservative force to change its state. Okay, so when I take this up with examples, it will become more easy to understand. But just write down the definition first. It is the energy of a system associated with its state. Okay. And what we mean by associated with its state, that if the system has some internal conservative force such that to change its state, we have to do work against that. Okay, then we know that the system has potential energy, the property of potential energy. And delta U is defined as the work done against the internal conservative force for the state change. Okay, so let's understand this with a simple example. The most intuitive example to understand is potential energy of a spring. We just saw that spring force is conservative. Okay. So now we have this situation that, you know, suppose we have a spring of spring constant K and of natural length L. and k is the force constant of the spring. Okay, now we know over here that to change the state of the spring, that is either compress it or extend it, an external agent will have to apply some force, and do work. Do work against the work done by the spring, or the work done by the spring force. And that spring force only is the internal conservative force. For the spring. Okay. So in this case, if the external agent applies force to extend or compress the spring, then work done by the external agent will be equal to negative of work done by the spring, because the spring is massless, so there's no change in kinetic energy involved, and that will be equal to the change in potential energy of the spring. So we will do this calculation also next, but just note down this concept. Okay, so let's understand this in more detail now. So what is happening is that, for example, suppose the spring is extended by an external agent. From x equal to zero, that is relaxed state, to x equal to d. So this was the initial state. Oh, you have some writing left. Okay, finish that. We'll come back. Okay, you can just write in brief because I'll send the notes. Important thing is you understand the concept, okay, which I'm explaining over here. Okay, and so this is okay now. Okay. So now let's look at the calculation based on this. Okay. So suppose an external agent is creating a state change, you know, from relaxed state to an extension. Okay. And this is being done very slowly. So there's no kinetic energy involved. In any case, the spring is massless, so there's no kinetic energy involved. So this is the initial state. Okay. Whereas after some time, by the application of external force, yes, this is what has happened. The length of the spring has got extended by D because some external agent is pulling it like this. Okay. So what we will say in this case is that the work done by the external agent is equal to the change in potential energy of the spring. Because the external agent has done work against the spring force. Which is the internal conservative force. To change the state of the spring or the configuration of the spring. Okay. So now we'll calculate how much that is also. Okay. So suppose if the spring constant is, let us say, 20 Newton per centimeter. Okay. And we extend it by, D is equal to 5 centimeters. Then we want to find the change in potential energy of the spring. Okay, so let's see how that happens. So the important thing here is that the external force will be a variable force. Okay, because it balances spring force. Okay, and spring force we know is variable. It has a magnitude of kx. So just note down this section and we'll discuss about the calculation next. You don't need to note in detail, just the basic idea. Then the calculation you'll see in detail. Okay, how we'll get that. Thank you. Okay, so let's see how we will do this calculation now. So from the initial state now, where this is at, oh sorry, there's no block involved. We'll come to the problem with the block later. So from the initial state now, where the spring is in natural length condition, at some intermediate time, if we are here, where this is L plus X, okay. So at that point of time, the external force acting here, it will be equal and opposite to the spring force. So this external force will have to balance the spring force. So it'll have to be kx in magnitude. Okay. And then from there, suppose this is making a very small displacement, dx. So the work done by the external agent during that is F external into dx. That is kx dx. Whereas if you also see the work done by the spring during that time will be minus of spring force into dx because they're opposite in direction. Okay. So at some intermediate time, when x is equal to x, that it is still less than d, for a small extension dx, to increase the extension by a small amount dx, this is the work done by the external agent. Okay. So kya ho raha hai na? We are going from this initial state to finally this state. Our final state is going to be here, where this is x plus d. But we are going step by step now from here. It's not a sudden extension. The external agent is slowly pulling the spring so that you are extending it from this initial state to this final state. So in between at some intermediate stage now, when the value of the extension is still less than d, because x is going from 0 to d. Yahan pe kya ho raha hai? The extension of the spring is 0 in the initial state. Aur yahan pe kya? The extension of the spring is d. But at some intermediate time when it's less than d, at that particular moment, how much force you're applying? The amount of force you're applying is this. Okay. And therefore, now to go from x to x plus dx. Now, mera yahan pe extension badh gaya abhi. It has become L plus x plus dx. So by a small amount, the extension has increased. So for that small amount, how much work the external agent has done? This much. Okay. So this will become, so for the small change dx, okay, the change in potential energy will be equal to the work done by this external agent, that is becoming kx dx. Therefore, for the net change, that is from x equal to 0 to my final state x equal to d, the total work done by the external agent here is equal to the total change in potential energy, and that is going to become integration of kx dx from x equal to 0 to x equal to d. So that is going to become half kd square when you put the limits and everything. So delta u will become half of 20 into 10 raised to power 2, that is in Newton per meter, into 5 into 10 raised to power minus 2 ka whole square. So this will become 2.5 into 10 raised to power, what is it, 3 minus 4 plus 1. Okay, so 10 raised to power 0. So it will be 2.5 joules. This will be the change in potential energy of the spring. Okay, so now this calculation thing is important here. Just make a note of it properly. Make sure you understand the steps, the integration and substitution of the limits, then finally the values. Okay. K was 20 newtons per centimeter. So that's why we converted it to newton per meter. Okay, Prince, just write this down. Just write it down step by step. I'll explain again. See, the external agent is applying the force in the same direction as the displacement. Na? So, ye wale end of the spring pe, wo jo force laga raha hai, the end is displacing by dx, which is in the same direction. So, work done by the external agent is how much? Force into displacement. Na? Fdx. Now, how much is the magnitude of the force? It is equal to kx because it's the force that is balancing the spring force. Imagine now you're pulling a spring very slowly like this. So at every point, you'll have to keep increasing the force slightly so that you balance the spring force. So your force increases as the extension increases. So at some intermediate time when the extension is x, the force is kx. So for a small displacement dx, the work done by that force is kx dx. So that work is converted into potential energy of the system. You know, the potential energy of the spring increases by the same amount as the work done by the external agent to extend it. So the work done by the external agent to extend the spring, that is equal to the change in its kinetic energy. Change in its potential energy. Is it clear now, Prince? Yes, Prince, are you clear with this part now, Uttam? Okay, so hope this example is clear to all of you. So this is just the one single example of change in potential energy of a spring. So now coming back to what we were discussing about earlier. So for any system, okay, which has an internal conservative force, to change the state of the system or configuration of the system, okay, the work done by the external agent against the internal conservative force. So this internal conservative force, we will give it the symbol of F internal conservative like this from now on. Okay. That work done by the external agent is negative of this, or negative of work done by the internal conservative force, and that is equal to the change in potential energy. So this is this definition. So this thing equals the change in potential energy. Okay. So the work done against the internal conservative force equals to the change in potential energy. Okay. So that is the general relationship, that delta U is equal to negative of work done by the internal conservative force. So this becomes the mathematical way of defining the potential energy, that the change in potential energy is negative of the work done by the internal conservative force. Yeah, so see, Anshna, the definition is like this, that if we have to change the configuration of the system now as an external agent, then to change the configuration, we have to do some amount of work against the internal conservative force. Now, so that amount of work done against the internal conservative force to change the configuration, that is equal to the change in potential energy. You know? So the work done by the external agent against the internal conservative force. So the amount of work done by this guy against the internal conservative force, that is equal to the change in potential energy. Understanding the point, no? Like in the previous example, to extend the spring, I had to do some work against the spring force, no? So I had to do some positive work. The spring force is doing negative work. Why? Because the potential energy of the system is increasing. No, not the state of motion, but energy related to state of motion, that is kinetic energy. This is energy related to just the state. यहाँ पे मुझे spring के speed से नहीं मतलब है, spring के state से मतलब है, whether it is having a compression or an extension, and how much compression it is having, how much extension it is having. In the case of the spring, no, that is what we mean by configuration. We'll talk about other systems also. You know? Okay, so we will understand this better with example. So I'm coming to that. Okay, so now based on this, now we define something called the work energy theorem. Like we had the work kinetic energy relation, now we have the work energy relation or the work energy theorem. So this work energy theorem is like this, that during any change for a system, for a mechanical system, okay, undergoing a change, the work done by the external agent plus the work done by any non-conservative force equals to the change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. Okay, I'll explain each of the terms, don't worry. This is the statement of the work energy theorem. Okay, where this is equal to the work done by any external force or forces. Okay, this is the work done by any non-conservative force. Example, friction. Okay. And of course, this thing is the change in kinetic energy. Okay. Where kinetic energy is the form of energy associated with motion. Okay. And this thing is the change in potential energy. Where potential energy is the form of energy associated with state of the system. State or configuration of the system. Okay. So just note this down, and as we understand this with examples, it will become clear to you. Yes, that is correct, beta. In fact, the type of potential energy of a spring, na, it is called the elastic potential energy only. Another name for the spring's potential energy is elastic potential energy of the spring. Okay. So let us look at an example. Okay, for the execution of this. Okay. So now a slightly modified version of that previous question that we did. We see now we are going to incorporate some more forces. Okay. Apart from the spring force and the external force. This is now a rough surface which has a coefficient of friction mu. And this is a spring of constant K, which is initially at its natural length state. And also the initially the block is at rest over here. Now what happens from t equal to 0 onwards, we start applying a constant horizontal force F. So a block of mass, let us say 2 kg, is attached to a spring. Let's say it has a force constant of 50 newton per centimeter, okay, on a rough surface. Say coefficient of friction is 0.2, okay, initially at rest. So this thing is also zero, u is also zero, and x is also zero for the spring. The spring is in relaxed state. Okay. Now, a constant horizontal force let's say of magnitude 20 newtons. Okay, 20 newtons will overcome the friction now. Just let me check. Yeah. 22. Yeah, it will obviously overcome the friction. Yeah. So F equal to 20 newtons starts acting on the block. Okay. Obviously applied by some external agent. So we have to now write an expression for the kinetic energy of the block as a function of the extension of the spring. Okay. So find the kinetic energy of the block as a function of x, that is the extension of the spring. And from that, find its speed v when x is equal to, let us say, 2 centimeters. Or 2 centimeters is a lot. Let's say when this is, wait a minute, we'll change the spring, this thing now. The spring constant, we will change it to something lesser because we are applying a force of only 20 newtons. So we'll change this to 10 newtons per centimeter. So when x is equal to 0.5 centimeters, when the block has been moved by half a centimeter, at that instant, what is the speed of the block? We have to find out. Okay. So just note down this question, then we'll see the execution of how we will do work energy, etc. Thank ओके पीपल, सो होप यू अंडरस्टूड. सो अभी देखो इसमें व्हाट वी विल डू ना, इफ वी टेक आवर सिस्टम एज द ब्लॉक प्लस द स्प्रिंग, ओके, देन फॉर दिस वी कैन सी दैट एफ इज एन एक्सटर्नल फोर्स. ओके, द फ्रिक्शन विल बी द नॉन कंजर्वेटिव फोर्स. ओके, इनफैक्ट mg normal reaction, these will all be external forces, whereas the spring force, that will be our internal conservative force, because at any intermediate time when this is the state of your system, so F is acting, mg is acting, normal reaction is acting, kinetic friction is acting, and in addition to that the internal force, spring force, is acting like this, you know, assuming that at this point of time it is L plus x. Okay, and the block is having an acceleration, let's say, because F is a constant force like this. Okay, so of all the forces, you can see there are five forces, na? So three of them are external forces, na? F, mg, and n, they are external forces, okay? Because some external agent is applying them. What is our system? The block and the spring. So you think, who's applying the force F? Somebody outside the system. So it's an external force. Who's applying the force mg? It's the earth. It's the gravitational pull of the earth. So that is not part of our system. Our system is only the spring and the block. So it's an external force. Who's applying the normal reaction? The floor. The floor is not part of our system. Okay. Who's applying the friction? Also the floor. But remember, the friction is a non-conservative force, so we will take it separately. Okay. And what about the spring force? It is something acting internally within our system. One part of our system is applying it on the other part of the system. The block is applying it on the spring. So it's the internal force, and it's conservative. So it's the internal conservative force. So now when we apply work energy theorem, we will say that the work done by all the external forces plus the work done by the non-conservative force is equal to change in kinetic energy plus the change in potential energy of the spring. This will become the statement of the work energy theorem. So note this down, and let's see how we'll execute this next. Okay. So when we execute this, you will see that the work done by the external agent is the work done by F plus the work done by mg plus the work done by normal reaction, but these two will be zero. This will be zero. This will be zero, because mg and normal reaction are perpendicular to the displacement of the block. You can see. Whereas the work done by F, that will be how much? That will be equal to F into x. Because if the block is moving from the initial state here, where x was zero, to some state here now, the displacement of the block is x. So during that time, the work done by F will be like that, no? Okay. Work done by non-conservative force is the work done by friction, that will be minus kinetic friction into S. So that will be minus mu mg into X. Okay. And now here the block had started from rest, and by the time it reached here, it had some speed V. So the change in kinetic energy of the block will be equal to half mv square minus zero, because the initial kinetic energy was zero. So now we are seeing each of the terms, how we are going to populate. This term is going to become fx, the work done by external force. The The work done by friction will be minus mu mg x. Okay, the change in kinetic energy will be half mv square, and change in potential energy of the spring. Now next thing we need to calculate. So we'll eventually have a formula for this, but we will first calculate this by the logical method now. Okay, now let's understand how this delta U will come. Now, the same method like we had seen earlier. So this change in potential energy, it will be the negative of the work done by the internal conservative force, that is negative of the work done by the spring force. This is the definition. Okay, that delta U is equal to negative of work done by internal conservative force. It is the change in potential energy equals to the work done against the internal conservative force for state to change. Okay, so that's why it is negative of work done by the internal conservative force. So in this case, you can see that the spring force is acting like this now. Okay, whereas the displacement in this direction. So work done by the spring force is integration of minus kx dx from the initial state x equal to 0 to some state x. So it is minus half kx square. So therefore, the change in potential energy of the spring will become negative of work done by the spring. So that will become plus half kx square. The potential energy of the spring is changing by plus half kx square from x equal to 0 to x equal to x state. This is what is happening. Okay, so this is very important to understand now. So as your spring is going from a state of x equal to 0 to an extended state of x equal to x, okay, this is the change that is happening in the potential energy. The change in potential energy is this. So now we've got the final piece of the whole equation, which is the delta U term. So we'll just plug each of the terms now in the equation and we will get the first term that we're looking for, the kinetic energy as a function of x. Okay, very good, Ganesh. So let me just clarify the whole thing. So people see, as per our work energy theorem, no, we had work done by external agent plus work done by non-conservative force is change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. So here this is becoming work done by F plus work done by friction is change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy for the spring in this example. This is the general work energy theorem. But when we apply it to this particular system, this is what is happening. So we have Fx minus mu mgx is equal to half mv square plus half kx square. So in that, we will substitute F as 20 newtons. Okay. Mu mg was becoming 10 newtons, I think. Let's just check. Yeah, M was 2 and mu was 0.2. Oh, sorry. So it will become 4 newtons. Friction will become 4 newtons and spring constant is 10. Okay. So friction is 4 newtons. Because M was 2 kgs. Coefficient of friction was 0.2. Okay. And the spring constant was 10 Newton per centimeter. Okay. So that is same thing as 1000 Newtons per meter. So this equation will become like this, that half mv square is equal to F minus mu mg into x minus half kx square. Or the kinetic energy as a function of x is 20 minus 4 into x minus 500 into x square. This is our kinetic energy as a function of x, where if we substitute x in meters, the kinetic energy will come in joules. So that is the answer to our first part. Okay, so now for that second partner, we just need to substitute the value of x as whatever it was, half a centimeter. So we want to find v at x equal to 0.5 centimeters. So just substitute this. So half mv square is 16x minus 500x square. So in this, substitute x as 5 into 10 raised power minus 3 meters. Okay. And M is 2 kgs. So we'll get V square as 16 into 5 into 10 raised power minus 3 minus 500 into 25 into 10 raised power minus 6. So this is becoming 8 into 10 raised power minus 2 minus 1.25 into 10 raised power minus 2. Okay. So that is 6.75 into 10 raised power minus 2. That is V square. So V will become square root of 8 meters per second. So it will be close to about 0.25. We about 0.26 meters per second. Yeah, it's nearly 2.5. Actually, it's 2.59 something, because you know square root of 625 is 25. But this is square root of 675. So that is about 25.9 or approximately 26. Like this. In fact, it's 25.98. So it's very nearly. Okay. Anyway, so that's the numerical calculation. Okay. So we will conclude here today, but just before we conclude now, we will see one important thing. If we compare the work kinetic energy theorem and work energy theorem. Okay. So in this system only, suppose we had applied work kinetic energy theorem. You would have said net work done is equal to change in kinetic energy. So that net work done would be work done by F plus work done by friction plus work done by spring plus work done by normal reaction plus work done by mg is equal to change in kinetic energy. So we would have got plus Fx minus mu mgx minus half kx square plus zero is equal to half mv square. So this is the value we would have got. Whereas when we are applied work energy theorem, we said that work done by external force plus work done by non-conservative force is change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy of the spring. So here we got work done by F, here we got work done by friction is delta K plus delta U. So we got Fx, the plus sign, minus mu mgx is equal to half mv square plus half kx square. So you can see that they are ultimately equivalent to each other. They're the same. It's only the statement which is different. Here we are saying that the net work done is equal to the change in kinetic energy. Whereas here we are saying that the work done by external plus non-conservative equals to the change in the two types of energy, the kinetic energy and the potential energy, because here we are applying it to a system, which is the spring plus the block. Whereas here, this is applied only to the block. Okay. So there's no question of internal force and external force. It is the net work done by all the forces put together. So that is the relationship between work energy theorem and work kinetic energy theorem. So we'll look at this relationship in more detail next time with more examples. Okay. And we'll see the advantage of using the work energy theorem and the concept of potential energy over work kinetic energy theorem. So all that coming up next time. So start working out questions from H.C. Verma. I will send you a list of questions that you can do from work energy. Yeah, both are equivalent. No? They'll give you the same value of half mv square. But the statement is different. No? Because one, we are applying the statement to the block alone. The other, we are applying the statement to the system. Okay. So you can see the statement of the theorem is different in the two cases. But on a application of the theorem, both will give you the same result about kinetic energy. Half mv square is F minus mu mg into x minus half kx. So they're equivalent. So yeah, go through some reference book like Resnick-Halliday or H.C. Verma about the basics of work energy theorem till the point we've discussed. And from H.C. Verma, you can start doing solved examples and the exercise problems which are related to the basic application of work energy. Okay. We'll discuss some questions from H.C. Verma also in the next time. So you can try out the first 25 questions from H.C. Verma exercise. Okay. That's it for today, people. Wish you all the best. You can try NCRT also. And you can try NCRT. But if you do H.C. Verma, it will not be necessary. So better is you do the, you know, H.C. Verma, then module. Okay. Then if required, after that, you can do from DC Pandey also. Okay. That will help you more in your numerical application compared to NCRT. You don't really need NCRT if you're doing these reference books. Yeah, Arvinda, H.C. Verma is enough, at least for JE mains, but for JE advanced, you need to do module also. Yeah, if you do H.C. Verma plus module, it is more than enough. It will cover all the exams. JE mains, JE advanced, BITSAT, whatever you need for boards, everything is covered. Okay, people, wish you all the best.